Please be seated.
Bismillah, hirrahmah, nirrahim. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, ever merciful. Assalamu alaikum. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon you all. With the permission of His Holiness, Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad Sahib, the head of the worldwide Ahmadiyya Muslim community, we will now begin the formal proceedings this evening. As with our tradition, we will start with recitation of a portion of the Holy Quran in Arabic. May I request Abdul Ghalib Khan to perform the recitation.
As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذ يرفع إبراهيم إسماعيل ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم ربنا واجعلنا مسلمين لك ومن ومن ذريتنا أمة مسلمة لك وارنا مناسكنا وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم ربنا وابعث فيهم رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياتك ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة ويزكيهم إنك أنت العزيز الحكيم.
May I now request the English translation by David Stephen Bell.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy, and the blessings of God be upon you. In the name of God, most gracious, most compassionate, the translation of the verses from the Holy Quran that we have just heard. And remember the time when Abraham and Ishmael raised the foundations of the house, praying, Our Lord, accept this from us, for thou art all-hearing, all-knowing. Our Lord, make us submissive to thee, and make of our offspring a people submissive to thee, and show us our ways of worship, and turn to us with mercy, for thou art oft returning with compassion and art merciful. and our Lord raise up among them a messenger from among themselves who may recite to them thy signs and teach them the book and wisdom and may purify them. Surely thou art the mighty, the wise.
May I now request the Northwest Regional President of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Association, Dr. Nasir Ahmed Chaudhry, to give a welcome speech.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, the Gracious, the Merciful. My beloved Huzoor, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu Alaikum. May the peace and blessing of Allah be upon you all. It is an honor and privilege to welcome you all on the auspicious occasion of the inauguration of Darul Amaan Mosque in Manchester. Honorable guests, Ahmadiyya Muslim community practices Islam in its pristine purity as taught and practiced by our Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace and blessing of Allah be upon him. The Ahmadiyya Muslim community was founded in 1889 in a small town in India called Qadian by Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salatu wasalam, peace be upon him, who under divine guidance claimed to be the promised Messiah and the reformer of this age. His Holiness Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad Sahib Ayyadullah Ta'ala bin Nasr al-Aziz is the fifth successor of promised Messiah. Distinguished guests, Manchester branch of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community was formally organized in 1968. The first mission house was purchased in 1980, and in the same year, it was inaugurated by Hazrat Mirza Nasir Ahmed, third successor of the promised Messiah. The present building was purchased in 1991, and Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmed, the fourth successor, inaugurated the renovated building on 30th August 1992. To fulfill the needs of the growing community, in 2007, an appeal was launched to raise funds for this mosque. By the grace of Almighty God, the promises touched the figure of £1 million in a very short time. Members gave or sold their property. Others gave away large portions of their savings. Women donated their jewelry. Children handed over their pocket money, all in enough effort to make this house of God. They deserve our thanks and prayers. Qazi Nasir Ahmed Bhatti served as the chairman of the mosque committee, and Mr. Roy Windle, our architect, designed this beautiful mosque. We are extremely thankful to the local council in the manner in which they have dealt with our planning application with understanding and kindness. 8th of March 2009 was a historic day when His Holiness laid the foundation stone of this mosque. Actual construction started in June 2010 and was completed in less than 2 years. This beautiful mosque has a minaret and three domes, two separate prayer halls for men and women, and two multi-purpose halls can altogether accommodate about 2,000 worshippers. This mosque is considered to be the second biggest project in size and capacity after our Baitul Futuh Mosque in modern Surrey, which itself is the biggest mosque in Western Europe. I want to pay special tribute to our National President, Mr. Rafiq Ahmed Hayat, Vice President, Mr. Mohammad Nasir Khan, and his team for their continued support and encouragement. Manchester has a rich diversity of cultures and incorporate people from a wide variety of religions and ethnic background. I want to assure you all that you will find us in the forefront to build a peaceful, harmonious, and prosperous society. We will always welcome visits from any peace-loving person or students from different schools. In the end, I want to thank you all for giving us your precious time and joining us in our happy moments. Beloved Hazur, I want to thank you on behalf of all the members for your guidance, continuous prayers, and especially for blessing us today with your presence. May Allah give you a long and healthy life. Thank you all once again.
Our next speaker tonight is Councillor Harry Lyons, the Lord Mayor of Manchester. Harry was elected to the council in 1996 to represent the Higher Blakely Ward and became Lord Mayor in May 2011. May I now request him to come and address us.
Your Holiness, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. This particular association and community was founded in 1889, which was exactly the same year as my longest serving employer, which was the NSPCC, which was a children's charity that was founded on the idea of safeguarding all children in this country. The association is established in more than 200 countries, and I'm delighted that Manchester has been chosen as a place to establish this mosque. It's a wonderful building, especially in this area of the city where I was born and lived as a child. I lived probably 100 metres from here for the first 16 years of my life. So it's very nice to come back. Green Hays was actually a district of Manchester, recognised as a district, and it's disappeared. All that's left is Green Hays Lane, and it's very, very nice to come back and remember those days. Absolutely nothing is the same. And I'm sure if this had been here in my childhood, it would have been a most magnificent building. If you like, showing up the local architecture at the time. Your association is committed to living by the law without agitation or violence and is therefore most welcome to our Greater Manchester community. AMA, by striving for peace and harmony amongst all people, is to be commended and gets the full support of the Manchester City Council, both up to the building of this mosque and for many years to come. AMA's respect for other religions is supported by me in particular, as respect for one another is the basis upon which peace and goodwill can prevail between various beliefs and non-beliefs. I think respect for others and their differences is a major requirement to containing any community in a peaceful setting. Your motto of love for all, hatred for none is a wonderful aspiration, and I wish you all the success you hope for in the future. Thank you for inviting me to this opening, and have a lovely evening. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Tony Lloyd, MP. Tony has been an MP since 1983 and represents Manchester Central. Tony has had a long-standing association with our community and visited our first mission house on Clarendon Road. May I now request him to come and address us.
As-salamu alaykum, Your Holiness, ladies and gentlemen. It's actually a great privilege for me to stand here. As you've just heard, I first came into contact with this community nearly a quarter of a century ago. I think my hair was a little darker. I didn't need glasses to read. But then I think some of you in this room also have the same the same changes that took place. Your Holiness, I've always been struck by the commitment of this community to the values that you and your predecessors have inculcated in your members, people who are committed to live with dignity, to live with peace within our wider community. And in that sense, as has already been said by Dr. Chowdhury and the Lord Mayor, the Ahmadiyya community here in Manchester is a very welcome part of Manchester's rich and diverse range of peoples, and a community that we are all very proud of. I want to pay particular tribute to Mr. Rajput, who I think I've known for all of the years, and who's since I came into contact with this community, and who's always made great efforts to keep me in touch with developments. I think it is important to recognise what enormous strides the community has made. I had the privilege of meeting your predecessor when he visited Manchester some years ago. I'm delighted to be here for your visit, precisely because this celebrates the opening of this important but really tremendous new addition to the buildings of Manchester, and one that's fitting for the people that this mosque and this centre will serve. I shortly will be moving on from parliamentary politics, because I intend to stand for the role of police commissioner here in Greater Manchester. But in that sense, this is not an election campaigning moment. If I am successful, obviously I will still continue to maintain my associations exactly with the community here. And Lucy Powell, who will almost certainly follow me into Parliament, is here tonight with us, and she will also maintain those close contacts, because that's what is the best of your community, the best of my city, which is the people working together, good people working for the betterment of what Manchester is all about. So let me finish by saying, on behalf of the widest community here in the Manchester Central Committee, I want you to know that you're amongst your close friends. You're very welcome here tonight. You're always very welcome. You're very welcome in particular as the head of people who contribute so much to our great city. Thank you.
Our next speaker tonight is Kate Green, MP. Kate was elected MP for Stretford and Urmston in May 2010. Kate has close relations with our community and attended our peace conference last year in Old Trafford. May I now request her to come and say a few words.
Thank you. As-salamu alaykum. And Your Holiness, thank you so much for inviting me to be part of such a special celebration this evening. And may I say what a beautiful building we're in tonight, a real addition to a great city, a great building for a great city, but more importantly, to be with more great people this evening who add to the richness, the diversity, and the goodness of all of our Manchester community. And I'm a very new Member of Parliament. I've only been in Parliament not even quite 2 years yet, but I've been delighted and privileged as a new MP to get to know your community here in Manchester. And I hope that although I've only had the first 2 years of my time as a Manchester MP, I'm looking forward to many, many more years of working with you and in friendship with you. And I want to say how welcome your community has made me as a newcomer since I've been the Member of Parliament for Stretford and Urmston. I want to say a particular thank you to Mr. Rauf Yusuf from Old Trafford in my constituency. Thank him for hospitality, but also for the education and teaching about what your community values, what it believes in, what it stands for. Love for all, hatred for none. I admire and I want to be part of that sentiment, and it's delightful to be with you here this evening to celebrate the message that you bring and the way in which you become part of our community here in Greater Manchester. I'm looking forward to perhaps one of the happiest evenings I've had since I've been elected a Member of Parliament, and I'm very proud and privileged to share it with you tonight. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Sir Gerald Kaufman MP. Sir Gerald was first elected an MP in 1970 and now represents Manchester Gorton. Sir Gerald was awarded a knighthood for services to Parliament in 2004. May I now request him to come and say a few words.
Your Holiness, Lord Mayor, it is a very great pleasure and privilege for me to be here this evening. My association with the Ahmadiyya Muslims goes back a very long way, and I represent a considerable number in my present constituency of Manchester Gorton. If the proposed boundary changes go through, then I shall become the Member of Parliament for this area, and it would be a very great source of pride for me to represent this beautiful mosque and the people of such a beautiful and lovely nature who make up the Ahmadiyya community. When we had the opening of the Millennium Dome in London, in which every city in the country had its day with school children giving a performance, the children of Manchester, when Manchester had its day, gave a play, performed a play about Manchester as a city of immigrants. And ever since the Romans were here in Manchester, we have had new people coming to our city, bringing with them their heritage and their beliefs and their love right through. And it is a wonderful fact that this city is a city of ethnic, religious, cultural, and if I can say so, culinary diversity. And it is one of the reasons why I am so proud to be a Member of Parliament. This evening is one of the most special evenings that I have attended during my nearly 42 years in the House of Commons. I'm about halfway through my parliamentary service at the moment. It's a beautiful building, marvelously designed, and it's a terrific pleasure for me to be here this evening with you. If you will allow me, Your Holiness, may I, from my own religion, pray that God continues to smile upon you and all your wonderful works of bringing love to all. Thank you very much.
Our next speaker is John Leach, MP. John is an MP for Manchester Withington and has been the Liberal Democrat Shadow Minister for Transport. May I now request him to say a few words.
Your Holiness, Lord Mayor, esteemed guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is a great pleasure to have been invited to come along here this evening. I have to confess, I've not driven past this building for some considerable time, and I was trying to rack my brains as the last time I'd been here, and I have to say, when I arrived, I was shocked to see the difference between the building that I came to previously and the one that we now have the pleasure of being in this evening. The Lord Mayor made the point that however many years ago that it was that he lived here, that this building would have stood out as a beacon amongst all the other buildings. I think it still stands out as a beacon amongst all these other buildings. It's a fantastic building and a tribute to all the hard work that has gone in to doing all the changes and the building work. Someone said that £1 million had been raised. I'm actually going to another event after this one this evening, which is actually a fundraising event at my own church. I think perhaps I could do with dragging a few of you along with me, simply to tell them how it's done, because I'm absolutely amazed that you were able to raise the money so quickly, and I think it's a testament to how the community works together, has raised the funds and done a marvellous job of making sure that you've been able to create such a magnificent mosque for you here in the heart of Manchester. That's really all I wanted to say, except thank you very, very much for the invitation. It's a delight to be here again among so many friends. And thank you very much, and I hope everyone have a great day. Thank you.
We are very fortunate that His Holiness, Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad Sahib, the head of the worldwide Ahmadiyya Muslim community, and the fifth successor to the promised Messiah, is blessing us with his presence tonight. I will humbly request that His Holiness deliver the keynote address tonight.
أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم All the distinguished guests, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Peace and blessing of Allah be upon you all. I would like to first of all thank all of our guests who taken the time and effort to join us this evening and enlighten the opening of our new mosque here in Manchester, which is called Darul Amaan Mosque. Your attendance demonstrates the strong ties of friendship that exist between you and the local Ahmadi Muslims. It is a result of these ties that you are attending, and indeed your participation is also an example of how you care for the feelings of others. Certainly, your attendance is a true reflection of your high moral standards, and it is exactly such elevated values which the entire world stands in great need of. Because, unfortunately, in today's world, selfishness and a sense of superiority have become widely prevalent. It is often said that humans are social animals, and thus living together and forming a society is a natural inclination. Yet, in reality, humans tend to group together according to their personal backgrounds, religions, or temperaments. Therefore, we find that people normally form their own close circles and groups. However, high moral standards are proved and demonstrated when people of different nationalities, cultures, religions, and social backgrounds are able to converse and interact freely with one another and come to form a strong relationship. Irrespective of the differences that may exist between them, it is a source of great pleasure to me that Ahmadi Muslims do not remain hidden away and isolated, but in fact endeavor to form relations with all segments of society and make efforts to integrate and interact with people from all walks of life. And certainly, such an attitude ought to be the hallmark of every true Ahmadi Muslim. However, I should also say that I am very grateful to all of you because you have not only accepted the hand of friendship that we have extended, but it is quite apparent that you value such relations very dearly. And certainly this attitude of yours is worthy of recognition and admiration. There is no doubt that you are extremely deserving of the gratitude and appreciation that I feel towards all of you. Indeed, the high value of your kind gesture rises even further when considering that this function is a purely religious and spiritual event in which a place of worship of the Ahmadiyya community, which according to Islamic terminology is called a masjid, that is mosque, is being inaugurated. With these words of thanks, I would like to speak briefly about the importance and the main objectives of a mosque in Islam. Unfortunately, we find that upon just hearing the word mosque, the hearts of many non-Muslims become instantly consumed with trepidation and fear. It is a common belief that all Muslims who are associated with any mosque must be religious extremists, and that perhaps it is in their mosque that such teachings are taught and encouraged. However, this is a completely false portrayal of a mosque. In reality, if every Muslim, and indeed even anyone, act upon Allah's instructions to those who enter mosque, then we would find the world would become a heaven of peace, love, and compassion. In chapter 7, verse 30 of the Holy Quran, which Muslims believe to be the direct word of God, Allah the Almighty has instructed that a believer should focus his attention at all times towards the mosque and should call upon God with sincerity. However, this teaching is prefaced by another instruction in which Allah the Almighty has commanded man to proclaim that my Lord has enjoined justice. This is because justice at all level is a fundamental requirement of Islam. And so if a person does not act in a fair and just manner, then his supplications to God Almighty and the effort he takes in going to the mosque are rendered completely void and worthless. Indeed, God has commanded Muslims that if they pray to him without keeping in view his prayer, then such worship will be completely rejected by him, and the prayers of such people will be a cause for their doom. Having established that Islam requires justice, it is pertinent to ask what exactly are the standards of justice that the Holy Quran demands. To help answer this question, I shall refer to a couple of verses from the Quran itself. In chapter 5, verse 9, in relation to the establishment of justice, God Almighty directly addresses those who believe, meaning those who claim to be Muslim, that they must bear witness with equity and stand forth in the cause of Allah. And in this verse, God Almighty further commands that the enmity of others should not lead to a Muslim to act unjustly, because to be fair and just is closer to righteousness. And then in chapter 4, verse 136, God Almighty has further commanded about the importance of bearing witness and giving testimony with justice and accuracy. In this verse, justice has been advocated to such an extent that Allah has commanded Muslims that they must be ready to testify against even themselves, their parents, their close friends and relatives. There can be no higher standards of justice than this, whereby a person is required to testify even against himself and his loved ones in order to uphold the truth. These are just a few examples from the Holy Quran that I have given in order to illustrate the essential ingredients for establishing justice and equity in society. And all Muslims who enter a mosque are commanded to act and abide by these very teachings at all times. Thus, how can it be that a person whose life is governed by the teachings of the Holy Quran and whose sole aim is to acquire God's prayer could ever cause any form of disorder or strife in society? And furthermore, how can it be that in a mosque, a Muslim learns to usurp the rights of other people? This could never happen because it directly contravenes the teachings of Islam. In the Holy Quran, God Almighty has very categorically stated that when Muslims enter mosques, their only intention and motive should be to worship Him sincerely. The word masjid literally means a place where a person bows down before God in a pure manner, with only the desire to attain His prayer. If a person prays with an impure state of mind and does not have the fear of God in his heart, then, as I have already mentioned, his worship will be completely rejected by God Almighty. Bearing all of this in mind, there's absolutely no reason for anyone to become fearful when they hear the word mosque. At one place, the Holy Quran commands that those people who enter mosque must enter with a spirit of sincerity and solely with the intention of worshipping God Almighty. Furthermore, to fulfill the requirements of worship, it is necessary that Muslim prays according to the method that God Almighty Himself has taught. Only then can he do true justice to God's right of worship. In relation to this, it is necessary to ask who are the people that worship God Almighty sincerely and in the correct way. And indeed, what is the correct way, method of a worship? To answer these questions, we look once again at the Holy Quran. It has taught that people who worship God Almighty properly are those who have adopted humility as the cornerstone and underlying basis of their lives. This is because God Almighty greatly appreciates humility. True worshippers display humility in all aspects of their lives. For example, if an ignorant person confronts a sincere believer and tries to quarrel or start a fight, then the believer would not rise to the provocation, but instead, to save himself from any wrongdoing, would quietly and respectfully take his leave and walk away from that situation in a dignified manner. In other words, such a person responds to cruelty and harshness with kindness and gentleness in an effort to create an atmosphere of peace and reconciliation. He is governed not by pride, but only a desire to please God and to help foster a peaceful society. Likewise, a true believer can never take the life of another person without reason, and neither can he ever wish to cause harm or suffering to anyone else. Where I have said that a person cannot take the life of another without reason, it should not be misunderstood that somehow this means that there is a right to take a person's life if you feel you have a justified reason. This is entirely wrong, because a Muslim has been taught to never take the law into his own hands. What is actually meant here is that to sentence someone to death on the basis of fabrication or conspiracy is totally wrong, and God Almighty is greatly displeased by such an act. True worshippers of God can never tolerate giving even the slightest false testimony. Moreover, true believers cannot bear to observe anything that is immodest, false, or obscene. And if by chance they ever come across such undesirable elements, then they remove themselves from the situation immediately in a dignified manner. All of these points have been mentioned in the Holy Quran as the hallmarks of true believers. Allah has deemed only those people who bear such qualities as true worshippers. These are the people whose acts and deeds are filled with piety and goodness, and hence they are recipients of His rewards and pleasure. Keeping all of this in view, when an Ahmadi Muslim constructs a mosque, he does so with two overarching and primary objectives. First, he tries to fulfill his obligation of worshipping God Almighty with even greater resolve than ever before. Secondly, he also endeavors to fulfill the rights of his fellow man and to serve humanity with an ever-increasing determination and passion. An Ahmadi Muslim will always try to distance himself from all types of disorder. So it is with complete conviction and confidence that I say to all of you that the only message that you will ever hear from an Ahmadi mosque is a call urging people towards God Almighty and a call to fulfill the rights of God's creation. Apart from these two noble objectives, you will hear no other call for message or message conveyed from an Ahmadi mosque. Indeed, this particular mosque has been named Darul Amaan, and this literally means a place of complete peace and security. It is a place of sanctuary where whoever enters will be liberated from all fears and distress. And I would also like to inform you that the status of the mosque as a place of refuge is not limited only to those who enter it, but in wider terms, it means that even those who live in the surrounding areas will always be safe and will never have any reason to fear the worshippers of the mosque. And not only will the local people be able to live safely and peacefully, but they will also find that every Ahmadi Muslim will stand shoulder to shoulder with them in an effort to establish a society filled with peace, love, and compassion. Certainly, the local people of this area will find that all Ahmadis will always remain at the forefront of every effort that is made towards transforming hatred and enmity into love and peace. Thus, I hope and very much expect that this mosque will become a symbol of peace and beacon of light, not just in the local area, but for the entire city and indeed the wider world. And this is exactly what the world stands in need of today. There is an urgent need for the world to become filled with compassion and tolerance so that true peace can develop, and we must all work together towards achieving these truly crucial pursuits. If we fail, then it is highly likely that another war will break out. Such a war, because the circumstance that it seems as if the war is getting nearer, approaching fast. Such a war will not be limited to a particular country or even a region, but will almost certainly engulf the vast majority of the world and will leave behind such a trail of destruction and devastation that we cannot even imagine. The effects of such a war will be tragic and will be felt not just by us, but by many future generations. That would be a truly terrifying legacy to pass on to our coming generations. And so it is my heartfelt request to all of you that within your own circles of influence, strive and endeavor towards developing peace and reconciliation so that we can come to live in a society where all enmities and hatred are left behind. May all of us come to value and respect one another so that we and all of us are protected from all forms of destruction. It is my sincere prayer that we come to achieve this paramount objective. In the end, I would like to once again thank all of our friends who have attended tonight's function and who, by doing so, have displayed their good nature and piety. Thank you very much.
Now we have charity check and gift presentations to the Lord Minister and Tony Lloyd MP for their nominated charities. His Holiness has kindly agreed to present these. So the first person to receive a cheque for £2,500 for his charity and the gift from His Holiness, his councillor, Harry Lyons, the Lord Mayor of Manchester. May I request them to please accept this cheque and gifts.
Thank you very much. I think the photographers want to take a picture of this.
Okay. No date.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
There's a gift.
Thank you. Thank you.
Nice.
And the next person to receive a cheque also for £2,500 and a gift from His Holiness is Tony Lloyd MP. May I request him to please accept this cheque and gift.
Thank you so much. It's a small gift for you as well.
Yeah, thank you. It's a great good in our municipal cancer hospital. So,
thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
We now also have some gift packs for our other distinguished guests. The first gift is to Kate Green MP. May I request her to please accept this gift.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And the next gift is to Sir Gerald Kaufman MP. May I request him to please accept this gift. And the final gift is to John Leach MP. May I request him to please accept this gift.
Thank you very much. Okay.
We will now conclude this evening's proceedings with a silent prayer, to which you can join us if you wish in your own way. I will now humbly request His Holiness to lead us all in a silent prayer.
Silent prayer. Ameen.